Assemblymember Bichotte, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
So, Assemblymember, please give us your bill of particulars and tell us about your own proposal to diversify the elite schools.
First, we have to recognize that we have 67% Black and Latinos who are attending the public schools, and only 9% are getting into these elite specialized high schools. So what we want to do, we want to have equal access across all of New York City. We're trying to make this program equal and fair. We have a number of Black and Latino students who are excelling, but they're just not applying, they're not taking the test. Many of them are not even aware that they could even take the test. So we're proposing that we do away with the test, and if not, make the test not be the only singular requirement to get into the school.
I want to put it out there that we're going to continue to fight and want to push to make sure that patients get adequate care and there's sufficient healthcare workers that can attend to their needs.
One of the bills that I'm pushing is to protect anesthesiologists and to protect our communities from being a two-tiered system. How would you like if an undertrained healthcare professional perform a very high-risk procedure on you that if a mistake is done, it can be life-threatening? We deserve quality healthcare in our communities. People are dying, people are sick, people cannot afford healthcare. With the New York Healthcare Act, it would allow all New Yorkers to get access to quality healthcare. It would help sustain our hospitals. We're looking to make sure that doctors have collective bargaining rights and that they are paid well and adequately.
This bill on vacancy decontrol, it is certainly needed. In my district alone in Brooklyn, we have the highest eviction rate, and it's really unfair because it's contributing to the homeless situation that's happening in New York City.
Housing has been the biggest issue in my district. Tenants are being evicted at a fastest rate. We are dealing with vacancy decontrol, preferential lease, major capital improvements, which are issues that are allowing landlords to evict our tenants so fast. So this year, we're making sure that housing is our priority. We want to repeal vacancy decontrol. We want to get rid of preferential lease. We want to make sure that major capital improvements are appropriately used so that our tenants are not constantly harassed and constantly displaced. Housing is a right.
These landlords take it upon them to harass these tenants and eventually get them kicked out. Many of these tenants do not have access to legal help or legal resources. So many of them are at a disadvantage already. I want to thank the Speaker and the Chair of Housing on this very, very important and historic piece of legislation, which is the Housing Stability and Tenant Protection Act of 2019. For a very long time, the rent has been too damn high, and it's still too damn high.
It was because of that one traffic light that was not on the corner of my house, which resulted in me almost losing my life. You know, at the age of 10, I got hit by a car. It taught me the struggles that people in unfortunate situations to go through on an everyday basis.
In the mid-80s, when I got hit by a car and almost died, and I could just imagine all the families and what they're going through, having to relive losing a child, losing a family member as a result of a speeding car. So as the assembly member, again, who's a co-sponsor of all the speed camera bills, it is clear and straightforward that the Senate must reconvene to extend the city's ability to use red light and stop light cameras in school zones. The safety of our children is not a political bargaining chip, and it is certainly not a partisan issue. Ask any parent. They will tell you politics ends with the lives of our children.
criminal justice reform. That is one of the major issues that we are all looking at across the state of New York. Victims like Khalif Browder, because he didn't have a speedy trial and discovery, because he could not afford cash to be bailed, he was in Rikers Island for 3 years. He was a 17-year-old. After finding out that he was innocent, he committed suicide. And a couple of years ago, we raised the age, but it was compromised. 16 and 17-year-olds, although they are not being convicted as adults, their records will be not sealed for over 10 years. That's really bad. We're also looking at issues around cash bail reform, speedy trial.
Last week marked the third anniversary of the suicide of Khalif Browder. Khalif took his life after spending 3 years in Rikers Island for something that he didn't do, stealing a backpack. I often think about Khalif and the thousands like him whenever the issue of bail reform is brought up. The time has come to do away with cash bail for misdemeanors and nonviolent felonies. We must have alternatives to bail, like turning in a gun or wearing an ankle monitor, which is what this bill actually.
My colleagues in the assembly in promoting this resolution on gun violence awareness in the month of June. Every day I get a call, almost every day I get a call from my local precinct about a recent shooting in my district. And it's sad because we cannot afford our kids to be continuously killed on our streets. Our streets should be safe havens.
Immigration reform has been one of the other issues that we're fighting for this year. We're hoping that we pass DREAM Act to allow children who came into this country who are undocumented to have an opportunity to afford to get a higher education.
To the estimate of the 4,500 undocumented students who graduate from high school every year, I see you and will continue to fight for your American dream as your American dream is ours American dream.
The opportunity program provides access, academic support, and financial aid to students who are typically lower income, academically challenged, but it gives them an opportunity to dream and have a promised future. Today I'm happy to participate in voting for the DREAM Act, an opportunity to commit to our hard-working, undocumented community of college-going immigrants. Yes. On what we have, we need to focus on fully funding what is due to our public school education system so that our kids are treated with equity, with justice, and have their constitutional right to a quality
education. This is pretty much simple and basic. You have 8,000 to 9,000 kids who have been deprived of their constitutional right to get a fair and just education. I hear criticisms around there aren't any checks and balances, we're setting a dangerous precedent. But the real key thing here is it's about socio and economic justice. What's dangerous is stripping a child's opportunity to excel. That's dangerous. What's dangerous is socio and economic injustice. What's dangerous is leaving a child behind. And the people of New York, the state of New York, have entrusted all of us to make sure that we fulfill a fiduciary responsibility that our kids are protected. Whether you're white, you're black, you're Jewish, you're Christian, no child should be left behind.
I am proud to support this bill sponsored by my colleague, which would prevent schools from losing aid due to COVID-19 closures. The current education law requires that school districts be in session for 180 days of risk losing state aid. The COVID-19 pandemic has caused many schools across New York State to close for periods exceeding the required time spent in session. In my district, which includes areas of Brooklyn that were hit
hardest hit by the pandemic, students have faced an uphill battle to get a quality education, especially students of color and students of in low-income areas. We're faced with disproportionate hardship when it comes to education. So these kids need the support of the state now more than ever. They should not lose access to education because of the pandemic or because state funding is pulled where it is needed the most. I encourage everyone to vote with me, with the sponsor, to make sure that students of New York can continue to compete on a global playing field. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I vote in affirmative.